Hello, I'm Rob Califf, and it's really good to talk to you all about the improvement trial. I'm here with Mike Blazing, the guy who really did most of the work in the improvement trial. And we have a late-breaking clinical trial presentation by Chris Cannon this week at the American Heart Association. Mike is giving the very important on-treatment analysis from the improvement trial. So Mike, maybe you can give us a little background about how the improvement trial came about and what it was trying to do.
It came about because there is a drug, ezetimibe, which blocks cholesterol uptake, leads to LDL lowering in the bloodstream. That should be associated with reduced events from a cardiovascular standpoint. That had never been proven, needed to be proven. And the companies at the time that had developed the drug, both Schering, Plow, and Merck, came to us and to Timmy with an idea, which we then fleshed out with them into the IMPROVE-IT trial.
So I had the sort of good luck of being around at the beginning when it was sort of a freak accident that ezetimibe was found to lower LDL cholesterol. They were working in an animal lab trying to do something else. And lo and behold, there was LDL cholesterol reduction. I spent about a year and a half going to meetings where they were trying to figure out what the mechanism was, and they couldn't, right up until the drug actually came on the market, because it had this nice effect on LDL and on CRP, but with a side effect profile that looked just like placebo. So it looked like almost the ideal sort of moderate to small LDL cholesterol reduction with no side effects. Right as it came on the market, the Niemann-Pick-like-1 receptor was identified as a mechanism. That also seemed great because the concept was you block cholesterol absorption, you wouldn't have any systemic effects, but then that sort of got into some trouble, didn't it?
Got into a little bit of trouble, and it got into trouble because of findings that were associated with the drug that it's not clear were truly associated with the drug because they were underpowered, such as cancer in a trial called C's. And then also got in trouble because there were some issues with regard to possible effects on gallbladder and or liver enzymes. Both, again, which have not been, had not previously been adequately evaluated in very large populations with the kind of rigor found in a clinical trial.
So when it came time to design the definitive clinical trial, there were several options. I don't think your option or my option was the one that the group ultimately decided on, but it was a good option that had a lot of challenges. Maybe you can just describe the basic protocol design.
The basic protocol design is relatively simple. We took individuals who came in with an acute coronary syndrome, made sure they were stabilized, and then placed everybody on a dose of simvastatin 40 milligrams. In order to meet what were the current guidelines at that time, we had to make sure that that population, when they came in, didn't come in with a very high cholesterol. If they had, then they would not be able to get to guideline-based therapy on the placebo or simvastatin alone arm. For that reason, we had an upper limit of 125 milligrams per deciliter of LDL for entry into the trial. So we had these post-ACS patients stabilized out to about 10 days, who then could be entered into the trial and randomized to either ezetimibe or placebo on top of baseline simvastatin 40, with a plan to get the placebo or simvastatin alone arm down to 70, which was the current guideline-based therapeutic level that needed to be attained at that point in time in 2005.
So the curse and the beauty of this trial, in my view, was that we knew that we were operating on that part of the curve of LDL lowering to outcome difference where it was relatively flat, because we were constrained by the ethics. You couldn't leave people at a high LDL because of the data that was already available. The beauty of that, though, was that we could predict with a lot of prior data what we were likely to find. And I think the surprise for a lot of people, even though we've written several papers about it, one of which you were the primary author and the other Chris Cannon was, we were looking for a very small difference.
Yeah, we were looking for an extremely small difference. The estimated difference we were looking for is between 8 and 9% for a treatment effect. But that's all that would be predicted from very large meta-analyses that have been done. The biggest key is the data that looked at that area of the curve, very low LDLs, down in the area of 50 for being treated, was all secondary analyses or exploratory analyses and no primary endpoint data. So we didn't know if this was a hunch or real. We had a strong hunch. We had good data to support it, but it was still a hunch and not proven.
So we got the trial started, and as you've already discussed, there were a number of Scud missiles that were fired at the trial by these spurious cancer findings, which were real in the SEAS trial. When they looked at the trial, there was more cancer in the group that got ezetimibe compared to the group that didn't. But we were able, because of a good relationship with our Oxford friends, to put together data from our trial and from a trial Oxford was doing and dispel that. And then there were all these things about liver and gallbladder, et cetera, that fell by the wayside. Eventually, though, we had to do a very large trial.
Yeah, we had to do a very large trial, and there were four big nuclear scuds and a bunch of other smaller scuds. The four big nuclear scuds were the SEAS trial, as you said, with the cancer scare, which was a safety issue. Two trials that questioned the efficacy of ezetimibe actually as lowering of PENS. Okay, that one called ENHANCE and one called ARBITER 6. And then the FDA itself, which right in the middle to middle end of our trial indicated that one of the safety nets we had had to try and make sure that individuals got down to that goal of 70 milligrams per deciliter on the placebo arm, an 80 milligram dose of simvastatin, they changed the label for the drug and said no more starts on 80. So we no longer could titrate people within the trial. So that's four nuclear scuds that I would call that actually tried to hit us.
And just to be clear on the FDA, since of course we all love the FDA, and
yes,
I do especially, I mean, that was probably the right decision for them to make for public health based on data.
It was. It just was very bad timing for our trial.
Yeah. So many people thought we would never get the trial done, but we did. And, you know, I still remember the moment, as you do in a trial like this, when you do the unblinding and you take your first peek at the data. It's a little frightening after 9 years of work. So what did you see when you took your first peek?
When I took my first peek, I saw that I had to flip through a number of pages to get to the actual result because we had a lot of data in front of it. But what we saw when we flipped to that was a statistically significant fall, 2% absolute reduction in event rates associated with use of ezetimibe, or the number needed to treat then that calculated out to 50.
And when you say major events, the difference was really in stroke and MI and secondarily in revascularization procedures, but
right,
totally neutral on death, right?
It was totally neutral on death, and the two big drivers were the hard endpoints of stroke and MI, correct.
And any surprises in the data that you could see based on what would have been projected from all the prior data?
No real surprises in the data at all. Mortality, we didn't expect to have a positive on. The most interesting kind of unusual finding that's a bit of a surprise but needs further investigation is the fact that revascularization has not followed hand-in-hand with MI and stroke. The revascularization effect was somewhat less than expected and less than seen in some of the other meta-analyses, but the effects on stroke and MI were very strong. So that's going to take a lot of teasing, a lot of investigation from the various different worldwide sites. We had 1,000 sites in the trial all across the world to see what exactly made that a little bit different.
And as I looked at it, the strongest outcome difference was in the, quote, hard endpoint of cardiovascular death, MI, and stroke as a triple composite, the one people put the most credence in, although for us it was tertiary because you unblind the trial for the main endpoint, then you go through a cascade. But still, that was kind of nice to see.
It was really nice to see. And it was also nice to see that every one of the secondary endpoints supported the primary endpoint. Everything was falling in the right way, and everything was actually statistically significant as well when we looked.
And then the one other thing that was very striking and very pleasing, the side effect profile and the toxicity profile looked like placebo.
Yes.
There were absolutely no differences.
There was no difference in major muscle events. There was no difference in liver or gallbladder events. And most importantly, cancer was dead even.
So at the investigator meeting, when we unblind, I'm going to have my bottle of ezetimibe out there, and I'm either going to throw it in the trash can or take a pill. And I've been taking the drug for a number of years, and I think after seeing these data, I will want to continue. But it does, I think in the perception, there's a really important issue. We see this small effect. Does that mean for somebody like me that has a relatively high LDL and can't take full dose statin without side effects, that ezetimibe is going to give me a little tiny effect, or what does it mean?
Well, again, we designed this trial knowing that we were only going to find a small treatment effect. We actually proved the concept. That was the key for what this trial had to show. If one normalizes the cholesterol change to a millimole, it does something similar to what's been done in Oxford in what's called the CTT trial analysis metadata, which took all of the current statin trials, about 26 of them, and looked. What they found is about a 20% reduction per millimole of reduction in LDL, 20% event reduction associated with a 1 millimole reduction in LDL. When you look at our data in the same way they looked at that, we fall very close to exactly the same line for all the major endpoints, making us think that the effect with ezetimibe is no different than the effect with a statin. The difference is we just made it's similar to making a very small change in a statin dose rather than initiating somebody on a statin and having a big change in LDL cholesterol.
Well, the other thing if you were me, your best estimate would be that I would get a bigger effect than the small effect we saw because it's a wider.
If your LDL is higher to start, you're going to get a bigger effect. If your LDL is lower to start, you're going to get a lower effect. But the same is true of statins.
So, and you've made the comment that the ezetimibe dose that we gave is the equivalent of tripling your dose of statins. Did I get that right?
That is correct. It's essentially the same. If you take a statin from 10 milligrams to 80 milligrams, you get the same effect by adding the ezetimibe to the 10 milligram dose of ezetimibe to a 10 milligram dose of statin with regards to LDL lowering. And now with this trial data, it looks like that will be more or less equivalent as well.
Just two more things to finish up here. I'm sensitive about this LDL theory. That people say, people will say, well, this proves it. All you got to do is lower LDL. I prefer to say, if everything else is equal, lowering LDL will lower your cardiac events. But there are certainly other therapies that lower LDL that don't lower cardiac events because they're offsetting toxicities.
Yeah, I think you have to lower LDL without any toxicity is the key. And that LDL also has to be lowered in a setting where it's actually being a primary target and not being dragged down, I think, by something else. So one also sees incredibly low LDLs in people with cancer, incredibly low LDLs in people with advanced diseases such as AIDS, and clearly that's not helping people either.
So the final thing is the fun begins now. What are the main analyses you want to look at?
The main analyses I want to look at after the HA are further delving into the safety data of this therapy with regards to muscle-related events. And because this database had somewhere around 12,000 people who got started new on a statin, and the way we designed our trial up front, we'll get a lot of data about how statins, how much muscle event or how much myalgia one would expect to have. So this will be a very, very nice tool for the clinician to try and estimate what the likely toxicity of starting any statin is in somebody, along with adding ezetimibe too. So they can look at both things within the trial. The second thing I really want to look at is the regional variation in vascular revascularization, because clearly that's the one endpoint that doesn't move exactly the right way. There's got to be something there, and I think it's probably going to be regional, and that'll be extremely interesting.
Well, my biggest interest is going to be in the cost effectiveness analysis, and the last thing I'll say is, in my career, this one is most like what I saw when we unblinded the Gusto trial. We were looking for a small difference, but it was a very important proof of concept of a theory of opening arteries faster and better. And the events were very meaningful, and the result was almost exactly what you would have predicted based on the theory. Here we have the same thing in another area of biology. It's just an amazing feeling to be part of it.
It is. It's nice when you get it right.
Okay. Well, great talking with you, and I look forward to a lot of fun over the next year analyzing these data.
Me too. Thank you very much.